Hello? Okay, we're on. I never know. This thing makes me more uncomfortable than anything else. So this is the second week of testimonies, and I'm a kind of person that just doesn't like to do things just to do things. So I want to say a few more words about testimony. Last week we talked about kind of why we need to do the testimony and what we represent when we do the testimony. And the thing I want to share with you today, one of the reasons why we have to do a testimony, because when we give our story and what Jesus has done in our life, we can change the atmosphere in the environment that we live in. Does that make sense? You know, the Bible has many names for our enemy, and two of them is the prince of the air and the prince of this world, all right? So as you can see, if you read a headline, if you watch news, if you just look what happened in the world, you can understand the environment we live in most of the time from this world is a toxic environment. And that's why the scripture says we are the light and the salt of this earth. You know, Jesus wouldn't need representations of the light if the world was bright, right? So most of the world's in darkness. Most situations we walk into need a change in atmosphere. And that's what we do. When we give our testimony, the atmosphere we usually walk into in the world, in the workplace, in our homes and stuff like that can be toxic. There could be no hope in it. There could be no life to it. There could be feelings involved in it. There could be hurts. There could be, I mean, most generally, it's negative. Now, our job as Christians, born-again Christians, is to change and influence the atmosphere that we walk into, not to be influenced by the atmosphere, but to change that. And I want to talk to you about David, all right? All you guys have heard the story of David and Goliath, right? And I just want to paint this out there. Imagine you will, a big hill on this side, a big hill on this side, and right in the middle, there's just a valley, right? Well, on this side, on this hill, are the Philistines and all the armies of the Philistines. On this side is all the army of the nation of Israel, all right? They're kind of at a stalemate because if one army advances, they go to the bottom of the ravine, and automatically they're at a disadvantage. They're fighting a battle uphill, right? So what's going on every day is there's this guy named Goliath. He's a giant. You guys all know the story. Bible says giants around, or Goliath's around 9 foot tall. It says he carries a spear that is wide as a weaver's beam. I don't know what that is, so look it up. And the tip of the spear is 15 pounds, all right? So this is a big dude. And what he does is he comes out every day. He's the only one that will advance to the bottom of this ravine. And what he does is he calls out the nation of Israel every day. He makes fun of them. Where is your God? First one to come out and face me. We'll square off. Whoever wins, the whole nation wins. If I win, the Philistines win. You become our slaves. If you win, vice versa, right? Every day. And what the enemy is doing, you know, I told you, I preach it all the time. When it's nation of Israel, God's chosen people, just like we are when we're born again. And the Philistines are the people of the land. They're the enemy, all right? Represent the enemy. What the enemy's doing in Goliath is setting an atmosphere of fear and impossibility, right? Because every time it says he comes out there twice a day, I think, and every time he comes out there, there's automatically a fear comes over the whole nation of Israel, right? Things get quiet. I'm sure you've been there in your life. You're ready to go, and then all of a sudden that one thing just pops up, and that fear comes on you, and you're just like, oh my gosh, there's that giant again. Well, David, being the smallest of his family, Dad sends him out there to check on him, and David overhears this. David's older brother's there, and David hears Goliath come out and pop off something threatening Israel, and David stands up and says, who is this guy, right? And why is he mocking us? Why doesn't someone do something about it? I would do something about it. David's older brother said, what are you doing? Shut your mouth. You know, someone's going to hear that, and you're going to have to back up your words, right? And, of course, David keeps going, and all of a sudden, the guys take him to Saul. David goes to King Saul, and King Saul says, what is this I've been hearing? What have you been saying? You're going to fight the giant, right? You're going to fight this, and this is where I want to pick up. We'll go 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 32. David said to Saul, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. So you got this young boy, going up and says, none of your warriors will fight this guy, but I'll go fight him, right? And Saul replied, and here's the atmosphere Saul's walking in. You're not able to go against the Philistine and fight him. You're only a young man, and he has been a warrior from his youth. This atmosphere that Saul, the king, the leader, is walking in is one of fear and impossibility. He's too big, he's too strong, you're limited, you're too weak, right? So this is what goes on. But David said to Saul, and here's the testimony, your servant been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it. I struck it and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by his hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them because he has defiled the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescues me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. All right? So at a moment when everybody was afraid, when everybody thought the situation impossible, David tells a story of his life. When I was out living life, when I was out just being me, David, doing what I'm supposed to do in everyday life, God showed up. And when a bear came, that's a big enemy. I defeated it. When the lion came, another big enemy. I defeated it. And I'll do the same to this problem. Now watch how this atmosphere changes. All right, Saul saying, you can't do it. It's impossible. You're just a boy. Now after the testimony that came from David, Saul said to David, go. And the Lord be with you. You see, the testimony of David and what he had been through and what he had had victory over changed the atmosphere around him and the people around him. It went from people being hopeless to we might have something here. It went from life being impossible to giving life to possibility. And that's what our testimony does every day when we face these giants, when we face these things. You know, we have to have a test to have a testimony. Well, when people are around us and all they see is the mountain, all they see the stuff in their way, that's when me and you are supposed to not only preach the gospel, but live the gospel. Hey, this is what God's done in my life. And this is what, and just like the time I defeated my financial problems, just like the time my marriage was in trouble and we took it to the Lord and we've been saved, we're going to handle this one just the same way. So the testimony isn't something we should maybe walk or maybe do. It's something we have to do because it gives hope to people that are facing their own giants. So what I'm going to do here is we're going to pray real quick. Josh, if you're ready, he's going to come up and give his testimony. So bow your heads with me. Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this testimony that we're about to hear. Lord, let this start a fire in our hearts today, Lord, to go out and share our story. Holy Spirit, I ask that you just fill this place, fill Josh, anoint his words. And Lord, let your message just come across clear and straight to our hearts, Father, and let us apply it to our life, that we just don't be part of a church, but we become the church, Father, your feet, your hands, and your servants, Lord. We just thank you for this, and it's in God's name, Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, Josh, are you up? All right, let's give Josh a round of applause.
Hi, guys. I just want to start out by saying that whenever I came here to engage, I was kind of at a rough spot in my life and in my marriage, and I owe a lot to Engage Church and Brant as a pastor. And I just want to say thank you to Engage and Brant for the impact that you guys have had on my life, because it's been a lot more impactful than maybe you think. I was trying to figure out what I was wanting to say in my testimony and everything like that, and I got to thinking just about life and what I've been through and everything like that. And I kept playing in my mind, well, how do I get that from here to on paper to you guys? And that just played over and over in my head, because if a lot of you guys know me, I'm not a talker. I mean, you see me on Sunday, I'm sitting right there, and I don't communicate well. You ask my wife. So I got to thinking about that, and it's hard to. I'm 28 years old, and I've been through not a ton, but I've been through a lot, and it was hard for me to put it all into words that I could share and not drag it out too long and not be too short. I worked on it and got it together. So here goes, I guess. So as most testimonies start out, is your childhood. I have two brothers, one older, one younger, and I have a little sister. Our childhood growing up, we grew up in a Christian home. We had a good childhood. Good upbringing. But I don't really remember a whole lot of my childhood. For some reason, I'm not quite sure. But I can tell you that I do remember whenever my life started to change a little bit. And that's when I was 11 years old. When I was 11, my mom left. And she left my dad and us kids, and she went to North Carolina to stay with her parents. And I remember whenever she did that, I mean, it broke our family. And I remember every night seeing Dad bowing on his knees beside the bed, just praying and begging God to bring her back. And that was every night for several weeks. And during that period of time there, I even wrote her a letter telling her, you know, how much we missed her and that she just needed to come back, and that wasn't right. And then I remember just one day that she just showed up, and I was little, so it was out of the blue to me, but I'm sure it was planned. But anyways, I remember going there in the kitchen, and she was in there, and I just gave her a big old hug. And I remember looking at her, and she was looking at me, and I said, Mom, I said, don't ever leave me again. And then I remember that I woke up that next morning, and before that, she said, I'll never leave you again, Josh, promise. And I woke up that next morning, and she was gone. And so that seems small, but to an 11-year-old boy, that wrecked me. And I mean, it seems small, but that little broken promise there affected me through every relationship that I would have the rest of my life, the relationship that I had with her, the relationship that I had with God. Because going through that at such a young age, it really played a toll on how I thought about things and how I felt about things. And seeing Dad praying and our whole family praying and everything like that for God to answer our prayers, and he didn't. That really tore me up, and I started to blame God of all things. So I started to blame God and everything like that. But as time went on, I started growing up, and we got enrolled in Aurora Christian Academy over here in town. And we went there for a few years, and everything got better. At this point, I still wouldn't talk to my mom. I don't think I talked to mom for about 2 or 3 years after that. my little brother and sisters, they still had contact, but I wanted nothing to do with her. And so after we got enrolled in private school and time moved on, as I got older and older, it just played in my mind that that this was God's fault. And then my freshman year, I was enrolled in public school. And all through this time, I always thought of myself as, a good Christian boy. And I was a good boy. And my freshman year, I was so excited because I finally got to play football and sports because ACA didn't have that. And so I was meeting all these new people, having all these new experiences, new friends, got to play sports. I was living life. I was good. And my freshman year there, I was introduced to alcohol, which I think most teenagers are probably introduced to alcohol freshman, sophomore year, I would assume, if not before. So with this drinking, I started to feel the need that I needed to party, I needed to drink to fit in. And so the more I partied and the more I experienced with things, I started to create my own new identity. And I knew that the things that I was doing was wrong from my upbringing. I knew it was wrong. I just didn't care anymore. And so I changed my identity and I made a new one to make myself feel better. Anyways, I junior through senior year of high school is whenever I started drinking more heavily and experimenting with more and more drugs. And I just was living a life of sin, and I still knew that. I just kept doing it because I liked it. It made me feel good. I was fitting in. I had friends. I was playing football. That's what people do. So I graduated high school and continued to drink heavily, more and more, all the time. It started to become a daily habit for me. And I remember going to Springfield one time because I was always partying with my friends. I hung out with the same group of guys. And we decided to go to Springfield one night. And I went to Springfield and we met at a bar there in Springfield. And playing pool and having a good time, or so we thought. And then we decided to leave and continue the activities of the night elsewhere. And after leaving the bar, headed to elsewhere, I got pulled over and I got a DWI. That was a scary night for me. But I thought of it as a horrible situation, and at the time it was. But it was a blessing in disguise, is when I look back at it, is what it was. So I want to read a verse right here real quick. It said, blessed is the one who God corrects, so do not despise the discipline of the Almighty. And so up to right now, I've been partying, drinking, trying to fit in with the wrong people and everything like that. And I grew up in a Christian home, and I knew better, and I did it anyways. And through all this, I was pushing God away, and I didn't really want to have anything to do with God or church or anything like that. And God was working in my life, even though I didn't see it or anything like that. He was always working in my life because he had bigger plans for me, and I didn't know that. But anyways, back to the DWI. I was at rock bottom in my life as far as alcohol, drugs, friends. I'd hit rock bottom. I was drinking every day. I was drinking at work. If I was awake, I was drinking. And that was just the way of life for me. And this DWI was a wake-up call, not by choice. I had to have a breathalyzer in my truck for 16 months. And so that kind of put a damper on my nightlife, as you can imagine. Through this DWI and looking at the situations that I was in and the situations that I have been in, I was thinking about my life and things like that, and I realized, you know, maybe I do have a problem with alcohol. Maybe. I didn't think that I was bothering anybody, so what did it matter? So I didn't really see a problem with it. I knew that I was drinking every day and that I did have a problem. So this DWI was a blessing for me because it slowed my drinking. It didn't stop it, but it slowed it. And it's kind of funny whenever I think about it on how God works in people's lives. Because I was a rough partying guy, and I slowed down, and people started to notice. And my wife, she worked at Murfin's, and we never talked or anything like that. And a little girl came in one day, and she just happened to mention that that Josh Boyd kid stopped drinking, and he's starting to straighten up his life. And God used that little girl right there to put the word in Chantel's ear. And through the grapevine, I heard that Chantel had a crush on me, so I did too. But anyways, I went in there and asked her out, blah, 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 needless to say, she's sitting there today as my wife. And so God uses that little girl in a bad situation to kind of turn me around so that I could get back on what he had planned for me, because I truly believe that God planned for me and Chantel to be married. She has been a huge blessing in my life, in our kids' life, and I hope your guys' life. Because without her, I would probably still be drinking. Probably wouldn't be in church. I don't know where I would be without her. So, anyways. We dated, and all through dating, our dating life, I was still drinking on a daily basis, still not getting drunk, but just drinking. I asked her to marry me. And she said yes, even though I was kind of rough at the time. And so I brought drinking not only into my life, but into Caden's life as well. I look back at it now and I'm like, well, what were you even thinking? Bringing that into your marriage and into your kid's life. Because you think about it, and that's just stupid. Because us as Christians, we're supposed to raise up our kids in the Bible and in church, and we're supposed to be setting the examples. And I wasn't setting an example at all, at least not a good one. So I continued to drink for about 2 years after that. And my wife finally had enough, and we got in a big fight one night. And about alcohol and how it was affecting our marriage. And she gave me the ultimatum. She said, you choose between alcohol or your family. And at first, that really just made me mad because I don't have a problem. I'm not an alcoholic. I'm not bothering you. I ain't getting drunk, coming home at 1-2 o'clock in the morning. So I was mad and I was offended. But I was on this side of the fence. I was on the inside. She was on the outside, and she was watching what it was doing to me, what it was doing to our family. And as a wife, she did what she was supposed to, and she stepped in. And she said, enough. And I'm very grateful for that. I wasn't at the time, but I am now. So she gave me the ultimatum. And it was very hard for me to give up alcohol. I had cravings for it. I didn't have the temptation to drink or to party or anything like that. And we kind of bickered about it because I'd be like, I just want one beer. Just one. Ain't gonna hurt nothing. And she said, no. It takes one. Then you want two. And so on and so forth. And so I'd quit drinking. And the temptation was there for a while, and then it faded, thankfully. And so now I just stay completely away from it. I wasn't very nervous, but I'm nervous now, so forgive me. But anyways, back to the way God works in people's lives. He was working in my life, not only with the DWI, not only with Chantel, to get me ready for the next chapter of my life. Because if it wasn't for those steps coming into line, then there, if those steps hadn't happened, I wouldn't have got back on track. After I'd quit drinking, my marriage was still in shambles from the alcohol. And so we had to fix that, right? What do most people do when they're in a bad situation, when they're at rock bottom and they need a way out? They pray or they come to church. And so we started looking for a church. And this was right at the time when Engage opened at the smaller church. And so we started going to church, and I sat there Sunday after Sunday listening to the sermons. But it wasn't just another sermon. The way that Brant preaches isn't like anybody else that I know of, because I get something out of it. And I remember him doing a sermon on your identity in Christ, and that got me thinking, and that's what I'm doing my testimony on, is my identity. And as I sat there in church listening to Brant, it really started to sink in that, you know, maybe what I was not taught, but what I thought in my head, is because whenever I think of Christianity or going to church, I always thought that you had to follow these rules that were impossible to follow for anybody. And so in that I thought it was next to impossible to even get in heaven, so why even try, right? That was my thinking through all the years. And so we talked about our identity in Christ and our relationship with Christ, and I slowly started to change my way of thinking that I was wrong in my thinking, that it's more of a relationship, which I've always had trouble with God. And so that really started to work in me, that, you know, I needed a relationship with God, and that that what I was doing and the way that I was thinking, it was just bringing me down, and I was my own worst enemy. My mind was condemning me when it shouldn't have been. So we started to come to church, and we've been here ever since, obviously. And so we start to look and think about the identities that I went through growing up: the good Christian boy, high school, the party drinking, good timing guy, to now. And I look at it, and as far as my identity in Christ, in the way that I'm thinking, my relationship with my wife, with my kids, my relationship with God, all of it is stronger than ever. And it took me going through all the things that I went through for everything to line up so I could have that relationship with God, so that I could have a good relationship with my wife, and so that I could be the father who sets a good example for his kids. And I owe that to Engaged Church. I owe that to my wife, my kids, to God for putting everything into play. And it's just crazy when I think about it, because I spent all them years not necessarily cursing God, but I was angry and I was mad with God. And it blows my mind to think that even through all that, every time that I pushed him away, every time that I didn't want to have anything to do with him, every time that I blamed him, he never once stopped loving me. He never left my side. He was always there doing work in my life, even though I didn't deserve it. And I'm just so grateful for that. And I'm grateful for Engaged Church. And I'm grateful for my dad that he could be here tonight. And for all the things that he's told me not to do and I did anyways. And for kicking my butt when it needed kicked. And just for always being there. And I'm thankful for my Engaged family. And you guys mean a lot. And I owe you guys a lot. And I appreciate you guys sitting here and listening to me ramble. And that's all I have. So thank you.
There we go. We serve a big God, amen. Man, if you just think about God for a second, just think about, I mean, that was Josh's life, how he just, you know, Jeremiah, I know I have the plans for you to prosper, not to harm you, and just how God networked Josh's life together. Now multiply that to about how many people's on this earth. What he's the glue that holds everything together, and he has a plan for each and every individual. But those plans interact and they meet and they clash together every day, and it's just amazing the control God has if we sit back and we look at it. I mean, we all have our story like that. Well, some of us might not, but I did. I mean, just like Josh being torn away, things in my early childhood that ripped me away from the desire to engage in relationship, and just the slow steps God put in my life and the people he put my life to bring me back on path, you know? And half the time it scares you to death, doesn't it, Josh? But we serve a big God, a God that loves us, a God that doesn't give up on us, a God that is always there, and a God that's just waiting for us to hit that moment in our life and turn back to him. One thing Josh said that it just really hit me is that he explained a situation that he was on one side of the fence, and Chantel and this little girl was on the other side of the fence. You know, that's God's plan, to take you from the one side and bring you to the other side to use you. And that's part of the testimony process. I mean, life happens, and sometimes we find ourselves in places we don't understand, we didn't ask for. Sometimes we did ask for it. But if we'll stop for a second, we'll find God and the person next to us, in a child's voice, in a spouse, in a best friend, or just an acquaintance. And you never know when it's going to be your turn on the other side of that fence to help someone else. You know what I mean? You never know the small things in life, the small things that God asks you to do, that's going to bring a broken person out of where they're at. So we need to remember that, I think, in everything we do during a day, every word we say, every look we cast. In my case, I may not say the words anymore, but I can give some looks. Right, Mike? Tori? I can give some looks. So I think we just need to pay more attention to that in our walk. So I'm going to pray and dismiss us. Make sure you go up and give Josh a hug. Tell him he did a good job. Next week, I think Carrie's going to give her testimony. I told her it was going to be tonight. I messed up. Her mom and dad came. But we're glad to have you here, right? So let's pray. Father God, Lord, again, I just thank you for the testimony that Josh shared today. Holy Spirit, let it sink into our hearts. Let us use that in our walk, Father, as a story of victory. Lord, I pray that that you use all of us in the way that you would see us fitting your purpose, Lord. Father, give us the strength and the courage to walk in obedience, to hear your voice among the chaos of this world, Father, that we hear you and we step in obedience in the things you've asked us to do, Lord. And Father, I ask that you just bless this week. I ask that you use your children here today to advance the kingdom, to touch others' hearts like Josh has touched ours tonight. Father, we just love you, and we thank you for all that you've done, and we give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.